My name's Paul Salam. I'm a therapist here at Southeastern Orthopedics. And just to give you a little forecast for this evening's talk, Dr. Spear is going to start off talking about the pathomechanics as well as the operative procedures for shoulder instability. And then I'll follow up with some rehab considerations, both for postoperative patients as well as conservative treatment for those individuals who don't require surgery. With that being said, I'll turn it over to Dr. Spear.
Thank you, Paul. I want to welcome everybody to tonight's symposium. This is one of a continuing number of symposia we've had. I think it's the first one on instability of the shoulder. Textbooks have been written about this, and this can be a fairly large topic, so we're going to go through it in a certain structured fashion, and I think that hopefully at a minimum it'll engender some discussion for everyone afterwards, and we will hold the questions after my talk, then Paul will speak, and then we'll have plenty of time for questions of whatever myriad of issues on shoulder instability you want to talk about. My talk is going to be more on the pathomechanics of instability. You know, what is rendered structurally damaged when the shoulder then comes out of joint or partially out of joint. And some of my clinical decision making, basically, I'm going to speak to you from what I am, a perspective of an orthopedic surgeon who sees this, about non-operative treatment, operative treatment, some of the decision making things that I go through in my head. First, the anatomy, and I have no doubt that everyone is well versed with all this, but we're talking about the pathoanatomy of instability we're talking about tonight. We're going to focus on ligaments. That's what, you know, instability is centered about. And ligaments connect bone to bone. So here's the glenoid part of the scapula and the humeral head. And the glenoid, the ligaments are going to attach the glenoid to the humeral head. And we'll get to some of the specifics in a moment. But the shoulder has several layers. Because tonight, when we talk about instability, it is a synonym of talking about ligament or labral pathology. But, you know, the shoulder motion is largely rotational. It's not translational. You know, there's a dot in the middle of your humeral head, and you rotate through probably the central or the inner 80% of your sphere of motion. That dot really shouldn't move more than a millimeter, maybe two. It's the shoulder, the stability in that range, which essentially is a functional range of motion, is largely rotator cuff. You know, co-contraction, compression in the glenolabral socket. The normal volume of the humeral of the shoulder joint is such that the shoulder joint can generally hold or contain two humeral heads. So normally, if I'm sitting here, my arm's up here in space or here, my glenohumeral ligaments generally are not taut. They're just not taut. And it's only at end range of motion do the ligaments become tight. If they're a check rein, you know, they're a static structure. If they are inadequate and some other issues are in play, the shoulder can sort of start to slide out of joint. But largely, shoulder instability through the majority of activities that we deal with is rotator cuff based, which is why someone may have an unstable shoulder, and we'll get to this later, is why, you know, physical therapy can be helpful with them, is that you can render them largely stable as long as they can avoid provocative action that takes them into a range of motion in which the ligaments are asked to come into play. So the shoulder ligaments, this is a nice sort of cartoon of this, I think. It's a glenoid fossa. So to the right here would be anterior, top would be superior. And the glenohumeral ligaments are largely sort of a confluent sheet of tendon. The way to think about the glenohumeral ligaments, it's more like an apple peel. It's about 1 to 2 millimeters thick. It has varying thicknesses, but about 1 or 2 millimeters thick. It's about as thick as an apple peel all around. And in the front, there's a few folds with some named ligaments, superior glenohumeral ligament, a middle glenohumeral ligament, the inferior glenohumeral ligament has both sort of an anterior band and a posterior band. And this posterior superior area really is not named. This is sort of more of a flat sheet of capsule. But that's the glenohumeral ligament structures which line the deep layer of the shoulders as the rotator cuff tendon is just on the outside here. What, for the purposes of tonight and for simplicity, since you know we have just a short time to discuss this, you know, I'm going to talk about instability in terms of probably 95% of the things that you see. You know, is it macrotrauma, meaning, you know, traumatic incident? Is it microtrauma, which to me means more repetitive motion, baseball, volleyball, swimming, things like that, or an exacerbation of hyperlaxity? Any of these can cause a whole spectrum of symptoms, and sometimes a very dissimilar spectrum of symptoms. So the classic is anterior instability. The shoulder dislocates anteriorly. It's trauma. The humeral head here is constrained in the glenolabial socket, and it simply comes forward. If it comes forward and stays forward for a period of time and has to be pushed back in, or someone has to render it back in, you know, that's a dislocation, a partial dislocation. We don't talk about partial dislocation is a subluxation. You know, why we don't call it a partial dislocation is probably just semantics. But anyway, that's called a subluxation. But either of them have a certain spectrum of patho-anatomy. And it's largely this. These happen to be are cartoons of arthroscopic photos, but it illustrates it. So here's the glenoid. This little rim here is the fibrous rim of the glenoid called a labrum. Now the labrum serves as both the attachment site of the ligament. So it's largely fibrous. It's not fibrocartilage. It's not exactly like a meniscus in a knee. It's mainly fibrous, not fibrocartilage, although there's a little bit of fibrocartilage at the interface as the labrum attaches to the glenoid. So the labrum serves two purposes, both quite important. One, it's the attachment side of the ligaments. But two, it deepens the socket. Generally, it's thought to confer about 50% of the depth of the glenolabial socket is the labrum. And that glenolabial socket is what the humeral head becomes, you know, conformed to, that allows the co-contraction of the rotator cuff to render the shoulder stable. So distortion of the glenolabial socket, meaning if you lose the labral, you know, I typically talk about in terms of patients like a bumper. If you lose the bumper, the shoulder can slide a little bit more easy than if the bumper is there. So in the shoulder anteriorly, the shoulder comes out the front. Here's the glenoid. The labrum detaches from the bone. Probably 95%. It's very consistent pathoanatomy. Very consistent stuff. You know, the shoulder dislocates anteriorly. What tears? The ligaments pull off the bone and create a structural distortion there. That's called a Bankart lesion. Now, in a very small subset, the ligament can pull off the humerus, and that's possible. Very, very, very unusual. This is by far and away the most common thing. Now, one of the challenges that we'll get into is that this interface, this detached labral glenoid interface, this detached sort of fibrous labrum to bony glenoid, that interface doesn't heal without surgery. So, you know, if you have someone who's had a shoulder traumatic dislocation, you know this thing's in there 95% of the time, and you know that which you're about to render in terms of what you can deliver as a physical therapist isn't going to make that heal. Still, you can resolve this thing clinically. You can't resolve it anatomically, but you can resolve it clinically. And ultimately, that the clinical is the, you know, that's, you know, that's the litmus test for the patient. I mean, they're better. posterior dislocation is similar. Here's the labrum, or the socket, the shoulder goes out the back. Much less common. Much less common. And posterior dislocations generally are a phenomenon of falling on an outstretched arm with the elbow straight. So we see posterior instability, contact sports, offensive linemen, hockey. Traumatically, someone falls, an outstretched arm falls off a horse or something like that. But usually it's this axial load of a forward flex shoulder with the elbow bent. Because if the elbow's not bent, then that force is going to be dissipated in the arm. I mean, you know, they might dislocate their elbow. They could do a number of things to their arm. But if that lever arm is made rigid, then you could highload the back of the shoulder and something's going to tear back there, or at least strain. It may not tear. And if it tears enough and the shoulder can come out the back, then this is sort of the problem that you get into right here. Before I showed you a cartoon drawn, this is an actual MRI. Here's the humeral head. That's the glenoid labrum, or the glenoid bone. Here's the labrum. Now, this white is fluid. It's an MRI arthrogram. It's basically this interface, which is nicely depicted by arrows, of course. That shouldn't be there. So this is the posterior labrum, posterior ligaments, that is detached from the posterior glenoid. That's a problem. That's the patient's pathology, anatomic pathology. And an MRI arthrogram shows that, because sometimes on a plain MRI, it doesn't show it as well. It's more of a thing of clinicians. But if you have a patient who might have some instability of the shoulder, and they've gotten has your doctor or whoever gotten an MRI? Yeah, they got an MRI, didn't show much. If it was a plain MRI, it can miss this stuff, because a lot of times imaging these labral injuries can be subtle or difficult, and what you need is to define it by contrast between here. So anyway, it's just something to keep in the back of your head, because sometimes diagnosis can be elusive, because it's not, what I just showed you are two things in which the diagnosis is not elusive. Shoulder came out of joint. The majority of time, clinically, it is not that obvious what happened. A lot of times there's plastic deformation, or there's usually plastic deformation. Again, the ligament system of the shoulder, think of an apple peel. It is flat, it is broad, and it is thin. There's a lot of elastin fibers in it. So shoulder ligaments tear by plastic deformation. So say unlike an ACL, it's like the opposite of an ACL. If any of you ever seen pictures of an ACL tear, ACLs just rupture. MCLs rupture. Ankle ligaments rupture. Now, in here, the actual distortion of the anterior ligaments, say, they can tear off the bone, which is the Bankart lesion. But the ligament itself is torn. It's damaged. But if you look at it, you might say it's fine. It's just plastically deformed like saran wrap. And that's a problem clinically for orthopedic surgeons, that we have to render that tension normal. And measuring that can be difficult. But, the best analogy is saran wrap. This is merely an ode to my favorite show. So the pathoanatomy resides in this that we're talking about tonight, the ligaments, the ligament interface and the ligament system. Another category is the microtrauma, and I think the classic model for microtraumatic shoulder instability is an overhead athlete. Around these parts, we see a lot of baseball, and through a variety of reasons, I see a lot of volleyball. These are injuries in which there is not an occurrence of the shoulder coming out of joint. There's merely pain and performance diminution, things like that. And part of it is that you just understand, here you are, you have a 19-year-old baseball player with recurring shoulder pain, and we'll get to some pain patterns later, but he's got bursitis and impingement and tendonitis, and so what's the diagnosis? Well, he's got some tendonitis and bursitis. 19-year-old baseball players generally don't get that. The problem is instability with some overlying rotator cuff tendon-based pathology. Now, a lot of it is, if you've ever seen, you know, some of these stop-action photos of a baseball athlete, there's tremendous distortion of the shoulder. So this sort of horizontal extension levers the humeral head anteriorly. It puts a lot of stress on the anterior capsule. A capsule that's about 1 to 2 millimeters thick, that has a lot of elastin fibers in it, and is generally not well suited for static check rein resistance. In the back of the shoulder, you get a nutcracker effect. This is something, in as an overhead athlete, it's a phenomenon that's coined called internal impingement. Typical impingement, or people call it external. I don't like the term external, but just general impingement is rotator cuff, anterior chromial spur, pain with overhead activities, you know, things like that. This internal impingement means you get these shoulders in this distorted position, which you can't put in statically. But if someone is throwing and you do stop action photos, the shoulder's going to go in that position. That if you look at it more closely, the undersurface of the supraspinatus or the undersurface of the supraspinatus infraspinatus abuts the posterior supraglenoid, because the ligaments in the front of the shoulder are too lax and the shoulder kind of levers back. That causes problems. The problem may be pain. The undersurface of the rotator cuff gets injured, the posterior superior labrum gets injured, but the pathology that renders it is the anterior capsule has become plastically deformed. Why? Well, there's a whole number of reasons why, which we'll get into. These are overhead athletes. The pathology is the anterior capsule, which is plastically deformed, stretched, meaning if it's supposed to be 3.5 centimeters long, it's 3.9 centimeters long. You know, it's slightly longer, not enough to render them functionally disabled through normal activities, but they can't play overhead sports at a high level. You know, they may say, well, I can throw okay, but I can't throw high speed. You're right. So in these athletes, you know, the pathology is subtle. And when someone dislocates, it's hardly subtle. So again, this is sort of a similar spectrum of instability, but a very different category of patient. Rotator cuff tears can predominate, especially these overhead athletes, because you get tensile load as well. They get a little bit damaged, and you force them to tensile load. The next thing, you have the rotator cuff breaking down on you. You get a lot of cuff symptoms and bursitis. The treatment is challenging. And Paul will get into this, but you know, it's not just the symptoms of these overhead athletes can be shoulder, cuff, bursitis. First, you have to have an insightful knowledge that this is the problem. Not that you can put your hand on and say, "Oh, yeah, it's unstable." That's not going to happen. You know, they may have myofascial pain, rotator cuff pain, and you just sort of know that this young athlete in front of you, this is what the problem is. You know, the treatment, you know, getting the rotator cuff stronger is important. I mean, obviously, you know, co-contractions, it can stress shield the labrum, I mean the ligaments, but that's merely the beginning. Then you gotta get the foundation, the platform of the shoulder, the scapula, periscapular muscles stronger. Then you gotta get the core stronger. And then you gotta be at least insightful enough to just to be sure that nothing else is going on, like hamstring inflexibility or something like that. And the notion in these overhead athletes that they didn't injure themselves on a certain play. It's their exposure to their sport that over time has created this pathologic clinical problem in the shoulder that you're being asked to intervene and help, which you may, you know, cuff strengthening, periscapular, core, hip, hamstring, the whole kinetic chain issues. But if you get them and they look awesome to you, I mean that they really look good, my thought, which is, you know, I try to make it as simple as possible. If they go back to their sport and do the same thing they did before, then why would you expect something different to happen? It's a little bit like of, you know, Einstein's definition of insanity, but doing the same thing, expecting different results. So to me, in these athletes, there has to be someone who can look at their sport mechanics and make some insightful observation, something to do something differently. So, you know, it could be the therapist if they have a lot of experience with it, or the coach, or both, or the athletic trainer, you know, but somebody. Final is a multidirectional instability. The phenotype of hyperlaxity is not uncommon, especially in adolescents, especially in females, especially in tall females. And in that type of patient to begin with, their rotator cuff, their shoulder strength is not that good. And so their shoulder is balanced, but not, but vulnerable to provocation. Then with that, a little bad luck, they may fall on an outstretched arm, they have some sport injury, their shoulder starts becoming unstable. And you recognize that this person has a lot of hyperlaxity. You know, they don't have to be Ehlers-Danlos syndrome or some clinical pathologic entity that is named or has genetic tests for. They're just loose jointed, you know. And you know, patients will say, I'm double jointed. You know, do their elbows hyperextend? You know, what about their knees? You know, things like that. This is a heck of a tough problem. And if someone has this, if someone has a developing unstable shoulder who is naturally hyperlax, you know, getting them stable is tough clinically. It's tough therapeutically from a rehabilitative perspective. It's tough surgically. It's tough. It's just tough. And to me, it doesn't mean we don't treat it, but it means that when this patient walks through your door and this is the problem, you have a pre-awareness that this is different. This is a little bit different. And you have to sort of, you know, mentally march through that as you go through your treatment algorithms. Non-operative treatment is strengthening. It's muscular coordination. It's the optimizing the dynamics of the musculoskeletal system. It's be sure that, you know, the middle trapezius is strong. Be sure the scapula moves well. It doesn't wing. It doesn't protract abnormally. Their core is strong, that they're not having some compensatory issues. This is for more the overhead athletes. But you know, someone who's unstable has had a traumatic, who's had a macro trauma, they've had a traumatic injury. Meaning if you were to get an MRI of their shoulder after the traumatic injury, there's blood in the joint. Now that gives them a fighting chance, and there's going to be some scar tissue forming. So that's good, and that might just help them out. So I mean, it's not going to reattach a labrum back to the bone, but it's going to at least stiffen the shoulder a little bit, perhaps. You would think that, well, if that's the case, then when someone dislocates, put them in a sling, and men make that thing heal down and all that, and that was in vogue. Must have been the 80s, early 90s, and I can't remember either. By mid-90s, late 90s, but it's been at least 10 years that there's been enough of a consensus in our orthopedic literature that in spite of the intuitive thought that shoulder dislocates, blood in the joint, put it in an interrotated posture and let it scar, that should help. It doesn't seem to impact the outcome. So I tend not to put them in slings. Just get a movement, get them in PT as soon as you can and see. Because, you know, your therapeutic effort is not going to really render any meaningful difference in these ligaments other than the 4 to 6 weeks it might take for a capsular sprain injury to settle down and behave itself, or the 2 to 3 weeks for a hemarthrosis and joint edema to sort of dissipate. But these shoulders hurt. Now, again, so I'm sort of jumping back and forth because it's hard to sort of put all this together in a seamless talk that has to be, you know, 45 minutes or less. So
for a lot of these patients,
the problem gets the pain, especially for the overhead athlete. The problem is the bursa. So it's like their core problem is they may have some plastic deformation, some stretching of their ligaments. They may have some fundamental weakness in their shoulder, some sport mechanics that are sort of maladaptive, and that's creating this problem in their shoulder, in which their shoulder is clinically unstable, micro unstable. The pain they're getting is a phenomenon of their subacromial space. It's bursitis, and you just have to recognize that this is what's going on. I mean, I've had patients. I mean, if I have an overhead athlete under the age of 25 coming to me with vague shoulder pain, pain with this sport performance diminution, it's instability to prove it otherwise. That's a purely intellectual diagnosis. I mean, they can tell me from across the room what their symptoms are and what they do sport wise. And then the physical exam is just to corroborate that. And I may end up doing an MRI to sort of corroborate it as well, which is why I am not a big fan of subacromial injections in these patients. I'm not a fan in general of injections in young patients. But bursitis is the pain generator. And sometimes getting their, and some patients have a propensity to develop a lot of myofascial pain. You know, their immune systems, when those things get revved up, they get hot, and some of the maladaptive clinical severity of that, in middle-aged to older patients is sort of fibromyalgia or something. I mean, some patients have a capacity to develop more myofascial inflammatory pain than other people with the same measure of provocation. It has a lot to do with, fitness and age and nutrition level and general health level and all that. There's all sorts of factors that are in play. But still, some patients are just prone to it, and some patients get a lot of pain. I mean, I have had three patients in the extreme. You know, I had a 14-year-old young girl who was 14 at the time, who for 2 years had shoulder pain so severe. She was at a pain clinic. She was from Tennessee, and she would try to play volleyball and all that, and nothing would work. And she had this tremendous. Almost a complex regional pain syndrome, an RSD type of problem. And you had this 14-year-old at the time, girl with this problem. And everything's been tried, and PT was tried. And ultimately, it was an intuitive leap to say, you have got to have some core instability of the shoulder. It's the only thing that makes sense. Either that, or you're just going to magically say that some young person has a chronic shoulder problem. And generally, my approach as an orthopedist, and I'm largely just a shoulder specialist in my practice now, my approach, and it may not be 100%, but my approach is that chronic shoulder pain does not exist in young people. I don't think it exists. Which means that, at some point, if I get someone under the age of 30, 28, who's got chronic shoulder pain, something is wrong. Now, at some point, you can get cumulative degenerative wear and tear and things that start to play. Then you can start to get some things come into play. But, when I especially someone under 20, I don't think it exists. And someone has, pain under the age of 20, I think has something real. Now, shoulder instability can cause mechanical symptoms, clicking and popping and catching. You say, if the humeral head's starting to come out of joint, and I think that's true. My opinion, which is I can't prove, but I think a lot of patients who have instability, who get mechanical symptoms, I think some of those symptoms are still from their subacromial space, just from perihumeral adhesions and fibrotic adhesions and all that. I mean, because it takes, you don't really get bucket handle tears or flap tears of labrum. For the humeral head to subluxate enough to engage a torn cartilage and somehow make it audibly painful, that's an event. I mean, someone's going to notice their shoulders coming out of joint. A lot of patients, move my shoulder, it's popping and catching. So, that's your cartilage tear. Well, it could be. I still think it's the perihumeral space causing the pain. So, surgery for me is one, if it fails to get better with non-operative treatment, and what the expectations are. Athletes, lifestyle that demands a stable shoulder. Again, shoulder instability is a phenomenon of end range of motion. So just don't use your shoulder end range of motion. Just stop it. Just stop it. That can be, you know, which is part of what sports medicine is. You know, it's an elective consideration that, you know, my shoulder, they have a history of an unstable shoulder. They've done some rehab. They've gotten it pretty good. They just can't go back to do some of the things they want to do. Okay, they can't do it. The question is that okay? That's why I tell them, is that okay? And if that's okay, then good. You have moderated your activities and lifestyle to accommodate your shoulder pathoanatomy so that your clinical result non-operatively is going to work great. Wonderful. Good. If that's not okay, then you need a better shoulder, which means you need to fix the pathoanatomy, which is surgery. And statistics are important. You know, if you have a traumatic anterior shoulder dislocation in a young athlete who's going to continue to play in that sport, the overwhelming likelihood it's going to come out of joint again. So I try to explain that, but I don't really push it too hard. You know, I don't want them to spoil, you know, two seasons. So, you know, I'll talk to them that, you know, this thing is probably going to come out again, especially, you know, if they have a cartilage tear, which is 95% certain. But certain athletes need it and all that. So there are some groups of patients that I'll talk about surgery right away. But that's less common because I think I don't treat as many of the college athletes that I did than, you know, years ago when I took care of college teams. So, you know, people who have a life, you know, they work. Or they may be students, but still, you know, they're not playing a competitive, collegiate, or organized sport. They don't need that urgency that, you know, if I don't fix this now, I'm going to miss, you know, something in the future. The surgery for the instability is now where everything gets very simple, at least conceptually simple. You take what is torn or damaged, and you rendered it in the way it was before it was torn or damaged. If the labrum is torn off the bone, you put it back to the bone. If the ligament is plastically deformed, and instead of being 3.5 centimeters long, it's 4 centimeters long, then you got to put a tuck in it. You got to tighten up a bit, and that's what you got to do. Judging tension. Now there's, you know. Physical therapy is a science, a scientific discipline, but as you know, there's a great art to what you do, how you handle patients, your interaction, your judgment. Surgery is anatomy and science and biology, but there's art as well. And there's something that's not art. You know, if a clavicle breaks and putting the bones back together, it's like, well, how do I put it back together? It's like a jigsaw puzzle. Just put it back until it looks right. Right? That's pretty straightforward. Repairing these ligaments, that is art. That's just judgment, you know, and that's just judgment. How tight can it be? Well, I put it till it looks right to me, which is, you know, because you don't want to over-tighten these shoulders, and you don't want to underdo it either. So now the surgical technique, arthroscopic repair works, open repair works. There's no doubt that both can repair these shoulders predictably well. The value is the shoulder, you know, is to get to the labrum and the capsule from an open technique. You got to go through delta pectoral interval, through the cuff, subscapularis. That is a long trip. There's a lot of morbidity. I don't care how good of a surgeon you are. It's a lot of morbidity. Now, you know, they might be just fine, but they might not. So the value in the shoulder especially is if you get to those deep structures without opening. It's the morbidity. It's not that you can't repair it open well. You can repair it great well, but with open. It's just there's too much morbidity in the journey down to the capsule. So arthroscopic has tremendous value in the shoulder for ligament and capsular repairs. And it's pretty straightforward. Here's the glenoid. Here would be like, you know, it's a cartoon of the detachment here. The red would be sort of the detached area. And you put in anchors in bone, you know, the glenoid. The glenoid in the shoulder is like oak. It's strong bone. Even you know, even as we age, you know, certain bones in our body become softer. The vertebral bodies, the femoral neck and heads, the humeral heads, but not the glenoid. So that glenoid's a good hard bone. So if you want to put an anchor in it, that's not a problem. We put these anchors in it that have sutures, and we pass sutures through it, and we tie it. It's really a pretty defined, well-recognized, well-rehearsed surgical procedure. It's not that difficult to do. Open, you do the same thing, except you got to go through a lot. The delta pectoral interval, you know, you don't really detach either, so you can go through the delta pectoral interval, retract the pectoralis major and deltoid, but this is what you got to go through. So this is the front of the shoulder here. This would be the bicep. This would be the subscapularis. You've got to go through this somehow, and that's the morbidity. And that's a lot of morbidity. It's a lot of morbidity. And historically, you know, this is sort of 60s, 70s, you know, long, many of you were, you know, grade school still, 80s of shoulder instability surgery, they had all these ideas. Well, I'm going to, excuse me, I'm going to repair the labrum. No, I'm going to do a putty plat. I'm going to tighten the capsule. No, I'm going to do a magnusen stack. I'm going to do this. Everyone had all these different things to do, and they all seemed to work. Well, the reason is that when you plow in the front of the shoulder and do something to the subscapularis, and then do whatever you want to the ligament. You can repair it anatomically. You can plicate it. You can do whatever. You know, let's put a piece of bone up there. Go for it. Whatever you want to do. All those things do one thing. They stiffen the front of the shoulder. So, you know, one of the challenges we had, like I finished my training in 92. And I came up from a fellowship that was pretty well ahead of most of the country in arthroscopic repair. There's a lot of resistance about arthroscopic repair. Because, well, you know, said, why do we need it? The gold standard is open reconstruction. And look at the data. The orthopedic data was the instability recurrence rate was less than 2%. Less than 2%. I mean, you know, that's a phenomenal outcome if you define your success rate by instability. Then people started getting much smarter and said, well, let's define our success rate. Instability is important. You know, if that was their primary diagnosis and if they stay unstable, well, then that's not good. But let's define it also in functional return. Because, you know, if you've lost 40 degrees of external rotation, your shoulder is not going to come out of joint in the front. That's good. Right? But if you've lost 40 degrees of external rotation, there is a lot of life activities you're not going to engage in. So the putty plats, great operation. Well, no, it's not. It's stiff in the shoulder. Everything's stiff in the shoulder. So the new emerging paradigm of shoulder instability surgery, which certainly began in earnest around 1990, I would say. By mid-90s, there was a consensus at our meetings. By 10 years ago, it's uniformly consensus, is that the clinical standard of dealing with an unstable shoulder is you got to return stability to the shoulder, meaning fixing the patho-anatomy, and restore full function, meaning get full range of motion. That's challenging. And that brings in tremendously more the benefit of physical therapy in these shoulders. Because, I mean, you can reconstruct them and repair them, and patients got, you know, you got to get their motion back, but, you know, not too much, not too soon, you know, things like that. So it brings in PT much more important because, you know, full range of motion and full stability, and that's what I expect. Okay. Now that's, you know, that's what we try to achieve. That's obviously challenging. But, you know, again, if you just want to stiffen the shoulder, then you can make the shoulder. I mean, it's easy to make the shoulder not come out of joint. It is not hard surgically. You just over tighten it. But if you do that, then you've revealed a whole wealth of other problems: dysfunction, pain, and then if you get unlucky, arthritis. Paul's going to go over this about protocols. This is my protocol, and it's not so much of what it is or as much as that when the shoulder is fixed, you know, and say, you know, all I can speak of is my patients, but here, but my rationale, the importance of protocol is that a lot of times in these patients, you have to understand how much you can push it and how soon you can push it, because sometimes the benefit of arthroscopic surgery is also the curse. The benefit is minimal tissue invasion, hopefully early pain resolution, shoulders feeling pretty good, hopefully allowing that they're just rocking and rolling through their early PT, and the temptation, the seduction, is just to keep them ramping right on through because they feel great. Don't do it. You've got to respect the biology of the repair. And usually with shoulder instability repair, you're repairing a labrum, a ligament, fibrous tissue to bone. That is the slowest interface in the body to heal. It's a complex interface. You know, bone to bone, well, like skin to skin, a week. You know, ligament to ligament, 4 weeks, 6 weeks, you know, tendon to tendon, longer. But the slowest interface in the body is what the shoulder is full of. Ligament to bone, and then tendon to bone. Then in like rotator cuff, if your tendon is diseased or aged or dysvascular, you know, that's another topic why rotator cuff repairs are difficult. But it's a tough interface, and do not underestimate that this is not going to heal readily. This is not like putting two pieces of bone together, and in 4 to 6 weeks, you're gonna have some clinical union. This is slow. It takes 3 months. And the fact that the shoulder feels great means they're doing well. Then they have to pause. And so I'm big, you know, generally my approach, I keep them in the sling for 3 weeks. Then at 3 weeks, they come out of the sling, and then for a month, I'll assign them some physical therapy with certain parameters. I want them to hit 40 degrees of external rotation, elevation to 140. Many times, especially if most patients, especially if they're younger or fitter and all that, they may get that within a week. And then they say, well, what do you do? Then you just pause. I'm sorry. You just pause. I come up with something to occupy their time for a while. Sometimes they're sore and they're achy, myofascial pain, they're stiff, and you know, there's plenty of stuff for you guys to do. But you don't progress until they get to a certain point. Then about 7 weeks out, you know, I'll let them push the full range of motion. Generally, what I want to see is what I like to see, and I'm going to finish with this. If a patient is 3 months out from shoulder reconstructive surgery, which I do arthroscopically and just rarely do open now. If I'm doing something open, that means it's some hugely salvaged, you know, someone, you know, and there's a role for that. It's a salvage operation. I mean, there's a role. If someone's had 2 or 3 failed arthroscopic procedures, and at some point, and they're failed by people who are good arthroscopists, and this thing is just not, it's just not working. And the shoulder's coming out of joint, and they're dysfunctional, and they're painful. You know, the idea is, well, I'm going to do a fourth arthroscopic procedure. Now, I mean, at some point, listen, what we need to do in your shoulder is make it stop coming out of joint. That I can do. You know, I'm going to do an open procedure and a capsular plication and make them a little bit stiff. I'm inviting other issues, but at some point you have to determine that it's a salvage case and we're going to stop your core problem. But what I want to see at 3 months, when they're sitting in front of me and I examine them, idea, if I could dial it in, I want to see they have about 80 to 90% of their passive range of motion. That's what I want. If it's my wish list. If they have 100% of it, oh, Dr. Spear, I'm doing wonderful. Look, I have 100% range of motion. Don't want it. Not at 3 months. I want about 90%. I want that ligament. I want everything to be a little bit thicker. Just a little bit thicker. Then as they start to ramp their activities up, it'll sort of stretch out. They'll get that last 10% over the next month or two or so. That's what I want. And no matter how good they're doing, I will compel them not to do a contact sport for 5 months, which means, you know, falling, football, hockey, riding a bike on the road. Because to allow them to do that, you have to understand that what happens if they fall? Can their shoulder withstand falling off a bike? Not until 5 months it can't. So if they want to ride, go ahead and ride. It seems odd that they can't ride. So if you can ride. You just got to be guaranteed that you're not going to fall. Then,
They can't guarantee that. Or if you fall, understand you're at risk. So with that, that's sort of my sort of algorithm and an approach to it. I think the physical therapy is extremely important in this. And it's an interesting segue into Paul's discussion, you know, from a therapist's perspective, because this is one area in which what you are rendering to the shoulder and improving to the shoulder is distinctly different than their pathoanatomy. There's nothing you're going to do to improve their labrum or ligaments. The question is, can you get everything else around it so balanced and so dynamically reconditioned and recharged that the shoulder functions beautifully, accepting some core pathologic issues? And the shoulder can deal with a lot of pathology if it's well-toned, well-conditioned, and the patient has a good understanding of the things he just can't do anymore. And they're willing to accept it. So with that, I'll turn you over to Paul.
All right. So obviously the theme here is shoulder instability. So I'm going to pick up sort of where you left off on, start with the post-operative treatment, sort of just touch on some of the highlights of the protocol we use here, precautions, goals at certain points, and again, time frame. And then I'll get into the conservative management of non-operative shoulder instability and the rehab that goes along with that. And that's probably where I'll spend most of the time tonight talking in that conservative realm after we go through the post-operative portion of it. So, as we sort of already alluded to, most of you are aware of, patients who have this capsular reconstruction, labral repair, the first 3 weeks they're sitting at home in a sling. They can engage in wrist flexion extension actively, elbow flexion extension actively, grip strengthening, but absolutely no shoulder motion. In what we call phase two of the protocol we use here, around somewhere between three 6 weeks, 3 to 8 weeks post-operatively, we discourage sling use. So no more sling, allow that shoulder to assume its normal positions with walking, sitting, that sort of thing, but really no active use of that shoulder. Obviously no weights, no bands, no isokinetics, weights, and the precautions, as we already talked about, keeping the passive range of motion to no more than 140 degrees of elevation, no more than 40 degrees of external rotation, and a hitchhiking thumb to L1 for internal rotation. Again, these are all passive ranges of motion. The treatment that we were able to do within this phase, again, the whole idea here within this phase is still to protect that repair that's very delicate at this point, and that's the ultimate goal, is not disrupting that repair. So we can do grade 1 and 2 mobilizations to help free up that that capsule, the tightness in there, if it's limiting to the range of motion that we have available to us at this time. Begin some active assistive range of motion. PNF patterns are really helpful here, particularly D2, whether it's through passive range of motion or active assistive, to help facilitate some light work in those muscles, but not too much. And aquatic therapy. If you've got access in your clinic, or the patient has access to it somewhere where they can get in the water and start doing some of these things, I think that's a great supplement to what we can do in clinic for them, and really help facilitate that motion and particularly their strength early on to what we can do. Again, one of the big I don't want to say problems, but challenges, is for those individuals who have this surgery, who are young, active people, particularly athletes, is holding back the reins when they start to really progress, and making that very clear to them early on, setting these sort of time frame in front of them that, you know, your shoulder might start going well, but you know, when you're stretching at home and when you're doing this, these are the limits, and not to push forward, which is the complete opposite of what our tendency is to do when we're treating them conservatively. You know, they start to get better and we continue to progress and give them more things to do, more challenges for the muscles, increase the range of motion. But as Dr. Spear alluded to, that's not the case here. We need to allow time for that to heal, as well as not to stretch out that stability that was created during surgery too early. isometric strengthening, whether that's flexion, extension, abduction at 0 degrees isometrically, isometric internal and external rotation against light resistance within the range that they're allowed to go through with internal and external rotation. Very light in clinic, manual resistance isometrically, and periscapular and cuff strengthening in that realm. Rhythmic stabilization is I think, another good tool that we can sort of do early on without stressing that capsule too much in that early phase two. And then in the latter stages of that phase, 6 to 8 weeks, maybe a little bit sooner, you can begin some active shoulder elevation if they're progressing well with active assistive, whether they're using a cane or whatever, making sure that they're not trying to do that initially in sitting or standing, that they're in some sort of incline, decline position, or maybe even supine, to reduce the stress on those structures that are delicate at this time. In phase three, which runs from about 8 to 12 weeks postoperatively, the goal here, obviously, is around that 12-week mark, is to get that full glenohumeral joint range of motion. Somewhere between 10 and 12 weeks, as Dr. Spear mentioned about the expectations, what he'd like to see in clinic at that particular time. So it's hard sometimes not to try and achieve, because that seems like the ultimate goal is to achieve full range of motion. But doing it too early can sometimes be a problem as they go on later on down the road. Here it sort of opens up our bag of tricks to whatever at this point. Mobilization is grade 1 through 4. Advance the rhythmic stabilization, the resistance you provide to the patient with that. And this is really where I think it's important to achieve that really good solid base of support in the shoulder, not just the cuff. I mean, the cuff needs to be strengthened, and you've got to make sure that that's working properly. But the periscapular muscles, which we'll talk a little bit about some strengthening techniques and all that stuff with the conservative treatment. And at this point, some of that sort of dovetails, because at this point you're, you know, working on the strengthening. There's no really precautions anymore. It's just what that shoulder allows you to do without causing inflammation, more pain, or sort of resisting what you're trying to impose on it. So achieving that solid base of support, but before trying to work on the larger movement of the shoulders, the deltoid, the pec, and those sort of things, making sure that base is set up first. Correct biomechanics prior to adding any real resistance in this phase. You want to make sure that they can go through their active range of motion and with light resistance, with good form, using the correct muscles when they need to, not developing some compensatory patterns, and really focusing in on the form, and then progressing the resistance once that form is down and the muscles are doing what we know as therapists they're supposed to be doing, and educating the patient about that. So cuff strengthening, periscapular strengthening, wise tees, narrow serratus punches, there's a ton of ways to strengthen the periscapular muscles, the cuff, and like I said, in the latter part of this talk, we'll talk some more about specific things, but man, there's so much we could spend all night talking about the different ways to, you know, sort of test the shoulder stability or the larger movements of the shoulder or work them together and all these different things. So we're just kind of touch the surface with the time we have tonight. As outlined in our protocol, phase 4, 12 weeks and beyond, if you're still seeing the patient at this time, to help them transition back to work or sport, which I think is key. If you kind of leave them hanging at this point and say, oh, well, you know, head out there on their own and I feel like I'm good to go. But I think there's a lot to be said about the interaction that goes along between the patient and the therapist, with them going out and trying something, coming back and saying, you know, well, when I was doing this, I felt that. And it gives us a chance to interact with them and sort of figure out new things for them to try or areas to work on that are going to be limiting to them as they return to sport or work or whatever activity it might be. So at this point, you should feel pretty confident in the strength that you provide in that shoulder throughout, not just the stabilizers of the shoulder, but the larger movers of the shoulder, and that they can take away what you've given them and be able to progress to the return to sport and work. So this phase two gives us the opportunity to sort of be creative and think about the things that we can work on with these individuals that are unique to their sport. So it takes an understanding of the individual sport, the position they play, the role that the shoulder plays in that position in whatever sport it might be, and then we can use our knowledge of the shoulder, the anatomy, the physiology, to make that better, make that happen. But really that can be lost if you're not working with them during that transition phase. That's important. Even if it's through email or stopping by the clinic or something like that. If they're, patients sometimes have limited visits where this is already a long rehab process and they might get cut short. But I think it's important to stay in contact with these patients and help them progress, particularly athletes or individuals who require more than what they've already achieved for their work or occupation. Now, at this point, too, we can introduce the throwing progression for overhead athletes, particularly throwers. It's important to have a protocol that you are comfortable with for returning to throwing. Either you or a colleague has had success with this throwing progression. Because it's not just, you've got the range to move through the throwing motion, you've got the strength to do it, and you send it back out there and they warm up and start throwing some pitches off the mound. It's a long process. So having a good throwing protocol, I think, is important to implement in this case if individuals are returning to sport. And then the mechanics, as Dr. Spear said, chances are something they were doing during the sport may have contributed to some of the pain they were having in their shoulder prior to having the surgery. So if you fix the instability, repair the labrum, you've gotten them strong, and they return to that same bad mechanics or bad form, or they don't strengthen their core, then you're setting them up for further pain or possibly injury down the road too. So, and we'll talk a little bit later too about those things in the conservative treatment portion. I threw this slide in here because I think there's a little bit of difference between individuals who have the surgery who've gone through a traumatic dislocation and those who, maybe haven't gone through the traumatic dislocation. So they may progress through some of the early stages fairly similarly, but some differences might be that they're a little bit more apprehensive with certain motions. They might be a little bit more stiff going through the rehab process. And typically, when there's a traumatic dislocation, there's some other structures involved that aren't in consideration with someone who hasn't had a traumatic dislocation. Possibly osseous structures, the labrum, which may have been repaired, nerve damage. Those sort of things are all sort of extra things to consider post-operatively for individuals who've had a traumatic dislocation that are coming to see you post-operatively from this. So, now, we'll talk about the non-operative management of shoulder instability. Just throw out a few terms out here. And there's a really good study, well, not study, a really good article that was put out this year in the Journal of Bone and Joint Surgery. It came out of the UK, and it's a really good overview of shoulder instability, hyperlaxity in individuals and athletes. And it's a really good read to sort of better understand instability and where things are at now in the field and in the general consensus. Hypermobility and hyperlaxity, just increased motion in the joint, that in and of itself doesn't create a problem. That hyperlaxity or hypermobility is a necessity for these individuals who are overhead athletes. By their training, the way they've progressed, they've asked their shoulder to move through greater ranges of motion than normal everyday individuals. So that's what they need to do their sport. And not everyone who's an overhead athlete is in pain. But what becomes the problem is instability. And that's when the mechanical structures or the mechanical structures of the shoulder fail to provide the stability that the shoulder needs in order to function without pain or pathology being implemented to it. Now, the hypermobility and hyperlaxity certainly predispose them to injuries, but that in and of itself isn't what we're looking at here. And then some terms, multidirectional, unidirectional, and bidirectional instability. It's just classifications, and just what it sounds like. Buys instability in two directions, unis in one direction, and multis in more than two directions. Some causes of instability, just briefly talk about some congenital causes. These that I have listed up here, Ehlers-Danlos, Marfan syndrome, osteogenesis imperfecta, benign joint hypermobility syndrome, they're all genetic mutations that in some way affect the collagen fibrils in our bodies. Now, most of these individuals are going to be diagnosed with these things pretty early on in their life, and it may not be what you're seeing in clinic. But Ehlers-Danlos is one that, you know, sometimes I think with young individuals, you might see them in clinic, and they may not have been diagnosed. And there's a quick screening tool called the Biten scale, if some of you are aware or not aware of. There's been some revisions to it lately, but the simple Biten scale for detecting Ehlers-Danlos is a 9-point scale. So the individual receives a point for each activity or motion that you ask them to go through. So can they dorsiflex their pinky to 90 degrees or beyond? That's a point for either side. Can they oppose their thumb to the ipsilateral forearm? That's a point for either side. Can they hyperextend their elbow beyond 10 degrees? That's a point for either side. Can they hyperextend their knees 10 degrees beyond extension? A point for either side. And then 1 point if they can reach the floor with the palm of their hands with their knees fully extended or hyperextended. So it's a possibility of 9 points, and a score of 4 or greater is indicative of the possibility of them having Ehlers-Danlos. Well, what does that mean? Well, that means that they probably have instability throughout a lot of their joints, and this is going to be something tough to deal with. It's just not, you know, unilateral instability. It's something a little bit different. More commonly, which you're probably going to see in the clinic, is the acquired instability, the overhead athletes, the individuals who for their occupation require repetitive overhead use, repetitive overhead activity, and just by the nature of what they do, their shoulder has become unstable or has more range of motion than most do. And then again, traumatic dislocations, because that's also acquired. So how are these individuals going to present in clinic? Again, this isn't going to be something that just kind of hits you. It's not necessarily going to be something that kind of hits you over the head, but some common characteristics. Young individuals, so particularly females more than males, and typically it's going to be, the symptoms are going to be unilateral. The instability or the hypermobility might be bilateral, but symptoms are typically unilateral. They complain oftentimes of the feeling of the joint slipping or being unstable. This dead arm sort of feeling where a patient might say, you know, it feels like, you know, sometimes my arm falls asleep or it just feels like I lose control of it, particularly with pitchers in the late cocking phase of throwing will say, I get back here and all of a sudden my arm just feels like it just loses power. It feels dead. This is a common characteristic of instability. But if that's the case, you want to make sure to screen for radicular symptoms as well as thoracic outlet syndrome to make sure you're not dealing with something either in conjunction with this or something different than shoulder instability. And the pain's usually diffuse throughout the shoulder. Dr. Spear went into really good detail about the pathoanatomy of the shoulder, and I think this is really one of the key points in dealing with shoulder instability, and dealing with it well, is to have a really good understanding of the static and dynamic structures of the shoulder, how they work, when they're supposed to be taut, what they're supposed to be doing, and really understanding that, because understanding that and then going into your examination allows you to pick up on things that you wouldn't normally pick up on if you didn't know all those things or things to look for. So, talk a little bit about maybe a typical exam you go through with someone who comes in that you might suspect shoulder instability. And again, this is probably one of the most important, as it is with anything, is your examination process and developing a problem list from that, which then guides you in your treatment. So This allows you to identify the cause of the shoulder pain and instability, but then you've got to distinguish between the two. As Dr. Spear talked about, there's oftentimes they're coming in because of the pain, the bursitis, the rotator cuff involvement. And then looking at that and looking at the instability and figuring out what to do with both of them. You gain a lot from the individual when, as you're going through their subjective exam, getting the history, when it hurts, how it hurts, where it hurts, feelings of instability, slipping, things of that nature. Bursitis is probably going to be the major source of pain. The internal impingement that Dr. Spear talked about, general impingement, all having an effect on the rotator cuff, and that's the most common factor that goes along with shoulder instability is some sort of cuff pathology. There's some concordant movements that sort of correlate with directions of instability. A thrower who reports pain with throwing or loss of velocity or pinching, typically they're going to have some anterior instability. Pushing open a heavy door, feeling a slip or feeling that the shoulder is not, you know, feel it moves a little bit, posterior instability. Carrying a heavy bag in one hand and feeling that sensation is indicative of inferior instability. Looking at the active range of motion, in an individual that you suspect shoulder instability, you expect them to see, you know, fairly normal range of motion, but it's important, as I think with any shoulder pathology, but probably most with this, is that you're actually looking at the shoulder. If it's a guy, have him take off their shirt. If it's a woman, get them in a sports bra or put them in a gown, something where you can expose that shoulder. Take a look at how the glenohumeral joint is moving, the scapular thoracic rhythm, how everything's moving together. Is it what you would expect? Are there areas that you're suspicious of tightness, just how they move through actively? Is the scapula winging? Do you suspect some weakness because of how they're sort of hitching through the motion or pain? Looking for these biomechanical abnormalities, which you really can't see with an individual who's wearing a shirt. So you really got to inspect that shoulder visually during their active range of motion, as well as when you're doing other parts of the exam. Passive range of motion. This gives you an opportunity to look at some of the areas of laxity, along with some of the special tests, which we'll talk about in a little bit, as well as areas of tightness. So that may sound counterintuitive to look for areas of tightness in the shoulder that is you're suspicious of laxity or instability. But one big thing that is something you don't want to miss is the possibility of there being some posterior shoulder tightness. Because oftentimes with an overhead throwing athlete who demonstrates anterior instability and an internal impingement sort of syndrome going on there, more often than not, they're going to have some posterior shoulder tightness. And if that's missed during exam, and you note the anterior translation, the anterior instability, you know, we really need to strengthen the cuff and just get everything strong, and part of your focus is strengthening the posterior musculature, further increasing that posterior stiffness, allowing that anterior translation to continue, their symptoms are probably going to get worse before they get better. And if they do pretend it's getting better and they return to their sport, if that's not addressed, they're going to get pain again. So that's one thing I think that sometimes is commonly mislooked, but if you look at it and identify, you can really be successful in treating these patients who have it. Now, not everybody has shoulder instability has that, but you know, just making sure that they don't is a good idea. At this point, you can do some mobilizations to get a better understanding of how the joint's moving as well. And then this idea of glenohumeral internal rotation deficit or decreased internal rotation and being linked with posterior shoulder tightness, it was first described in 2003 by Burkhardt et al. In the Arthroscopy Journal. They did a three-part series. I think it was on the dysfunctional throwing shoulder or the disabled throwing shoulder, something like that. They were the first ones to sort of talk about in the literature this link between decreased internal rotation and posterior shoulder tightness. And that was talked about, you know, it's been talked about and continues to be talked about in the literature. So some of the treatment methods that some therapists introduce is that, well, okay, we recognize that the posterior shoulder is tight, so let's work on increasing internal rotation. Tim Tyler et al., who's out of New York and has done a lot of research in posterior shoulder, both measuring it and decreasing it, put out a study earlier this year in the American Journal of Sports Medicine, where they took 22 patients who all had posterior shoulder tightness, pain, obviously, and they measured their internal rotation, external rotation, and posterior shoulder tightness, as well as their pain with some sort of outcome measure, pre and post physical therapy. Treatment lasted between 7 and 12 weeks, I think, plus or minus 2 weeks. And what they found was that individuals who had complete elimination of symptoms, no more shoulder pain, return to sport, return to work, shoulders fine, they had very big improvements in increasing posterior shoulder, you know, posterior shoulder laxity. Their posterior shoulder was no longer tight, it moved well, but their internal rotation stayed the same. There's no significant difference. So one thing that might help us understand is that if we see this internal rotation deficit in a tight posterior shoulder, that maybe the focus shouldn't be on increasing internal rotation, but working on the extensibility of that posterior capsule in helping to reduce symptoms. So not looking at that internal rotation deficit as something that you're trying to fix, but more so trying to increase the extensibility in that posterior capsule. Because one of the things that changes as an athlete, an overhead athlete, increases their external rotation is that their internal rotation decreases. So if there's about 180 degrees between the two of them, then that's typically what you're going to see. But I think that's important to look at. And then strength. You know, testing those 22 muscles that affect how the shoulder move. And not only, you know, so looking at them during your exam as you went through active range of motion with the patient, you see how they sort of function as a unit and how they work. But strength testing, the individual's manual muscle testing their individual muscles that you suspect might be weak, I think has some merit. Even though muscles don't work individually, having an idea of where that weakness is can help you create that problem list in order to tailor your treatment to that. And I'd say more often than not, the patients that I see, young athletes with shoulder instability, come in and almost always their middle trap, lower trap, rhomboids, and lats are usually weak bilaterally. And these might be very muscular individuals, you know, they're high-level athletes, but somewhere along the line, whoever's training them or, you know, strengthening coach or trainer is missing out on that aspect, and that's something key to pick up on. Special tests, we'll run through, I guess, some more of what you might call a popular special test for shoulder instability. Now, there's no one good special test because they all look at sort of different things or different areas of laxity. So you can kind of group them into provocation tests, tests that the concordant sign is pain, that's the positive sign, or laxity tests where you're just looking at laxity, not pain. So the following pictures I'm going to show that depict these special tests are how they were performed as originally described in the literature. It may not be how they've been rendered up until this point or you might be used to seeing, but how they were talked about first in the literature. So the provocation test we'll talk about, the apprehension test, the apprehension relocation test, and the anterior release or surprise test. And then for laxity, the sulcus sign, the hyperabduction test, the anterior and posterior drawer test, and the load and shift test. So this is the apprehension test. Patient sitting, arm in this position, this hand stabilizing the scapula, this one taking them into end range external rotation or until they report pain or apprehension. That's a positive sign. And the apprehension relocation test, same position, only patient in supine, and again, taken into external rotation until they report pain or apprehension. And then the clinician with this hand applies a posterior force on the anterior humerus. And if there's a reduction in symptoms, then that's a positive sign. And then the anterior release, is kind of redundant to all these release and re-release and surprise and all that stuff. But this test is started out earlier in external rotation with a force applied in the beginning, posteriorly. They're taken to their end range of external rotation, and then the hand is released. I don't do this one in clinic because patients usually don't like it. Salk assign. So those were the provocation tests. These are the laxity tests here. This is probably the most common. Everybody's familiar with the Salk assign to look for inferior instability in the glenohumeral joint. So this clinician here is applying an inferior force to the humerus and noting the separation there in the joint. There's ways to grade that, but just knowing that there's some instability there inferiorly. The hyperabduction test is another test for inferior instability. Patient in sitting, arm abducted to here. The clinician stabilizes the scapula here and with this hand moves them further into abduction. If they move beyond 105 degrees, it's positive for inferior instability, making sure that the scapula stays stabilized. The anterior and posterior jaw test, the positions are the same. The only thing that changes is the direction of the force. So you stabilize the scapula here and apply a anterior force in this direction, noting the translation that occurs. And then posterior jaw test, same thing, stabilizing the scapula and applying an inferior force. Now my hand isn't directly over top because I like to have one underneath because I don't know how unstable the patient is. And it gives me an idea of feel too. So I don't, with my mobilizations or with testing the posterior shoulder or anterior shoulder, I like to keep some sort of feel or guide in the area that I'm testing to kind of give me an idea and keep my whole hand around that joint. A load and shift test. This is a unique test among the laxity tests because it offers the clinician a sort of one-time test here to get an idea of inferior, anterior, and posterior laxity. So the scapula stabilized again. This hand applies a load to the glenohumeral joint, and then you move the humerus anteriorly, note the translation, posteriorly, note the translation, and then inferiorly. So it's all while you're providing that load, and then you just move in the different directions and get an idea. It's like doing a mobilization to detect laxity, basically, with just a little bit more of a load. I talked earlier about the posterior shoulder tightness and how that can be a key role if, you know, even if it is not something that presents all the time with shoulder instability, it's something that I think is worth looking at because in missing it, you can do a disservice to the patient. So there have been ways described in the literature to measure posterior shoulder tightness. Timothy Tyler published the first study looking at this in 1999, and he used the same position. This is one position to detect posterior shoulder tightness. Another one is supine, but going through the same motion. Supine is very cumbersome because it involves multiple people. So it's not the easiest thing to do in clinic. It might be great for research, but as a clinician just wanting to get an idea of posterior shoulder tightness, it's not very good. So the position best for detecting posterior shoulder tightness, if you suspect that during your exam, is patient sideline on the uninvolved side with a hand under their head to sort of create an aligned spine there. This hand stabilizes the scapula to be perpendicular with the plinth. And then this hand, with the elbow flexed close to 90 degrees, you drop it down horizontally until you note either a shift or a feeling of the scapula coming towards you or until that arm stops moving down. This is not a good indication of whether an individual has posterior shoulder tightness because the scapula is moving all over the place when they do that. The way that's been validated for validity, reliability, positive and negative likelihood ratios by Maury Colbert et al. Earlier this year in physical therapy theory and practice, he used a carpenter's square, which if you're not familiar with what a carpenter's square is, it's just an L-pieced shape of metal. That makes sure that that shoulder, that scapula stays up against and stays level. And as soon as that moves away from it, you can tell that that's, you know, then you take your measurement. And the way he was measuring was by strapping an inclinometer here that would be set at zero with the patient's arm in this position. And then you note where you're at as far as degrees when that shoulder either doesn't move any further or the scapula begins to move forward. So this, if you've got an inclinometer in one person, is a great way to sort of get an idea of posterior shoulder tightness during exam and then measure it during your progression to see if your treatment is actually producing some extensibility in that posterior shoulder, if that's what you're after. Following the exam, I think it's really important to educate the patient about what you're trying to accomplish, you know, because if you tell them, okay, your shoulder, you know, you've got some rotator cuff involvement, some bursitis, and that's what's causing the pain, but your shoulder's unstable, their first inclination is probably going to be as an athlete, that I just need to get my muscles stronger, and what they're used to working out are sort of the mirror muscles, the larger muscles in the shoulder that aren't really going to help provide that stability. So at least at the simplest level, helping them to understand that there are sort of two layers of shoulder muscles, each with a different role, the inner layer being the cuff and its ability to stabilize the joint, as well as some of the parascapular muscles, and then the larger movers of the shoulder. And without them working both together in the best shape, your shoulder is not going to get better. So helping them to understand why this, when they can bench press 250 pounds, is going to help their shoulder get better. Because if they understand that and you make that connection, they're more likely to be an active participant in the rehabilitation process, which is very important for outcomes. So treatment, first thing you want to do is be able to try and calm the shoulder down so that you can work with it. You can do the exercises, you can do some effective treatments in clinic, controlling that bursitis, whether it's medication, ice, rest from the sport if it deems necessary, and then getting back to the basics of building a good solid base of support for that shoulder and eliminating some of the poor mechanics that you may have identified during the examination. Because I think it's important too to use the examination as sort of a platform to look at sport or activity that's causing their pain, having them actually go through the motion, talking to them a little bit about their mechanics, knowing that you'll address that further on down the road. So these are just, like I said, there's just a few exercises. Internal and external rotation is good for people who, you know, at 0 degrees of abduction, good for people who have a really weak cuff and their cuff can't even support them out here very well without getting some signs and symptoms. But if they've got some cuff stability, you can work it a little bit more by being out here in some abduction, internal and external rotation against resistance. Y's, T's, and arrows, working the muscle, the parascapular muscles here, just help support the scapula, which again is really the stage or the platform on which that, you know, which that arm moves off of. So if that's not working well, or it's off a little bit or weak, or the scapula is winging, then that's going to cause problems in the glenohumeral joint as well. So I think this is a good place to start really building that solid base of support before trying to challenge things a little bit more in clinic. So I think most everybody's probably familiar with Y's, T's, and arrows. It's just the name of the position that you look like your arms are in. This is a little bit different than the typical arrow. Again, this is to work lats. All these positions are the positions that Kendall recommends you put the patient in to manually muscle test these muscles. It's the same position that you exercise them in. And it really helps to isolate those particular muscles. And again, patient education on, we're not interested in doing front raises with 25 pounds because you're not isolating your anterior deltoid. Your upper trap and other muscles are getting involved. But really isolating these muscles, you can make big muscular guys fatigue in 3 sets of 10 with this in 2 pounds because typically those muscles are weak and they need strength and they're begging for it. This is another little series I like with shoulder flexion, scaption, and abduction. And I use this not only as a treatment or strengthening tool, but also sort of for evaluation. If I think I've helped them or they've done their job to build up a good solid base of support, and then we try and do some of these exercises, and I have them do 10, 10, and then 10 and 10 all consecutively. And if they get fatigued, great. That's what I'm looking for. What I don't want to see is if they're getting some pain, some impingement up towards the top here, that tells me that their cuff isn't ready to be pushed at that point. They need to spend some more time building up that base of support before we start to challenge it any further. And progressing in a smart fashion, I think, is key in getting them back to what they want to do as quickly as possible without delaying their recovery. I'll throw this in here. This is just a way to perform scapular mobilizations. If you detect on your exam that any area or movement in the scapula is decreased or warrants some mobilization, this is probably the best technique I found to provide scapular mobilizations, because it frees up clinicians, both hands, to work on the scapula. The opposite hand of the patient, this one's underneath the head to assume normal alignment. This one is if you've got a belt loop, they can hook their thumb in the belt loop and rest their arm. So the arm's relaxed and you've got two hands to work with the scapula. So you're not having to support and do all this other stuff. This is a really good way to kind of move the scapula. I talked about earlier the possibility that the posterior shoulder might be tight. So how do you remedy that? There's a couple different ways. I like this method, although in reading a recent article, there's another method I'm going to try or test it out a little bit in the clinic today. For providing a anterior to posterior mobilization. But this one is the one that I probably use most often. And with pre-positioning, the patient in internal rotation and a little bit of horizontal adduction to sort of tighten that posterior capsule or sort of get it taut before you stretch, and then provide an anterior to posterior mobilization in this direction. And again, my hand's up here, but I usually like it down here so I can feel where that humerus is coming into contact with my hand, and if I'm stretching out the right structures. If the patient reports, "Ooh, I feel some pinching in the front," they need reposition because you're just causing some impingement in there. So reposition, maybe a little less internal rotation, less horizontal adduction, and apply it again. They should feel some discomfort or stretching in the posterior shoulder if it's done correctly. This is a good stretch they can do on their own. To increase posterior shoulder laxity or extensibility. The sleeper stretch, not a huge fan, because if you've ever had posterior shoulder tightness and try to stretch it out like this, it hurts. But it's effective, but it hurts. I kind of use this as a last resort if they're not getting much luck with this, or it's hard to find, you know, I can't really feel the stretch back there. They're going to feel it here, but just kind of take it easy with them. This whole idea, and this is just my thoughts, whether right or wrong, who knows. But as I kind of alluded to earlier, I like to strengthen the shoulder stabilizers and movers separately to begin with, starting out with the periscapular muscles and the cuff, working that, getting that good core of the shoulder strong before trying to work the larger muscles of the shoulder. So not only in the treatment progression, but as they return to sport activity or any exercise they're doing, I would always recommend that they start their routine with some rotator cuff exercises. Similar to if you're instructing a patient going to the gym to start some resistance training, and they're gonna do some core work. But do your core work before your exercise, one, to make sure you do it so you're not so tired from your other exercises you don't do it at the end. And two, you get the blood flow and you sort of create this idea that, okay, the core's starting to work, it's getting engaged, you're waking the muscles up, and then every activity you do after that in the gym, you're going to engage your core more than you did if you didn't do that exercise beforehand. I like to apply that principle to the shoulder too, in that if you warm those cuff muscles up, sort of get them awake, and then do these other exercises, that the core is more likely to stabilize that joint as the larger shoulder movers move it through whatever exercise you're having them do. And then progress to fusing these two together. And these are just some ways, again, there's tons of ways to do this, but having a ball, not necessarily doing a push-up, but holding this position for a period of time, that ball wants to move, believe it or not, and your shoulder has to stabilize it, and you will see their affected arm start to shake way before their other one. Because of the weakness. And you can do it with two hands or one hand. You can start with this on the wall with a small ball. They can do it at home with anything that wants to move in their hand, because that movement requires those muscles to try and stabilize that joint. And if they don't think it's working, I have them try it on the other side, and they can sit there all day long. But on the side that's affected, it fatigues out really quickly. The body blade is a great piece of equipment for individuals with shoulder instability. I'm not talking about the things you see on infomercials where shaking this blade's gonna, you're going to lose 20 pounds in 3 weeks. But this, if done properly, can really help to educate those muscles throughout, you know, even if I usually start with the, you know, just here or here in different positions, or start to move them through, you know, different planes. If you're not familiar with the body blade is, it's just a big piece of plastic that's weighted on either end, and you shake it and it keeps moving. So you got to kind of hold it to keep it from going all over the place. It requires some coordination, so if the individual is not coordinated, you can forget this exercise. But it can be really effective. So I start off with them with that, not trying to do a whole lot with the body blade, but just getting them used to it. Ball toss. Whether it's a weighted ball, I like using weighted balls, or any kind of ball, whatever they use for their sport, if you want to, you know, incorporate that. But this asks their shoulder to do a lot similar to what they're going to return to sport in. But I think even probably more beneficial is the things as a clinician you can gain by watching them do this. Having them do this exercise and seeing what's happening, you know, are they getting fatigued? Are they wanting to come down here? Are they wanting to move forward? How's that scapula moving? Is it seated nice on the thoracic rib cage, or is it winging? Where are their areas of weakness? Because hopefully you've strengthened that core and you're imposing this, and you want to see sort of where they're at. And I like this as a good tool. This is it looks easy in pictures, but doing this only with, you know, high level athletes. Who you really feel that their shoulder is good and strong, and now you're just testing them. They've passed all your tests, and now you're just, let's see what you can do with this thing, because everything else you're throwing at them is easy now, and that's good. But this is a push-up. You start off on a BOSU ball with one hand. You come down, and on your way up, you don't stop. On your way up, you switch both hands on the BOSU ball. Come down, on your way back up, you switch one hand off. So this is a boom, 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 quick sort of thing. And that shoulder has got to be working well to do this without pain. And this is a tough thing to do. So this isn't something you do with people you're not comfortable with doing. And then you can start to work on sport-specific exercises. Break down their motions. One thing we did a lot in baseball was with pitching coaches or throwing in the fundamentals is breaking down the motions and working on areas that you see lack good mechanics. And this requires, again, a good understanding of the individual's sport, their role in the sport, and what the shoulder's role and responsibility is in the sport. But you can really sort of break things down and analyze their form. And again, when you get to this stage in treatment, you're looking now at the whole chain. Everything's connected, right? So their shoulder broke down for some reason. So you've remedied that well with the shoulder. The shoulder is now stable, it's good, it's solid, they're doing things without pain, they feel great. But if things aren't addressed when they return to sports, things like for a pitcher pushing off the mound, their lower extremity strength, or their core is a huge thing in overhead athletes. If that core is not strong and it can't help to take up the force that you're asking the shoulder to take up, then all that gets transferred. Same with the legs. If the legs aren't weak, you push through, and the core can't stabilize it, and now the energy that's transferred to the shoulder isn't much. Now the shoulder has got to produce a tremendous amount of velocity in order to create that same pitch speed that they did when their legs were strong or their core was strong. So identifying those areas of weakness with some really easy techniques and tools you can use in the clinic to look at core strength or look at the kinetic chain in motion as they return to sport. If we do a great job as physical therapists up until this point, but then don't address poor mechanics or core instability, these problems are likely to happen again. So this is very important for those athletes that are getting back to their sport or people getting back to work. And then just one example of sport-specific exercises, taking that body blade and moving through a throwing motion or a volleyball stroke or whatever, imposing some sort of as close to the sport as you can get without them having to actually do it. And there's something to be said too. I've when I worked at a sports medicine clinic at a university, I would oftentimes, the athletes that I treated there, sometimes if I didn't have a good understanding of their sport, I'd go watch them play or watch someone play on TV like that and get a good understanding. I feel like I'm pretty well versed in sports and what most positions do, but cricket, I mean, it's a lot like baseball, but it's not the same. And the idea of what the shoulder has to do there with bowling as opposed to pitching is a little bit different. So, you know, take the time to kind of get to know that, and that'll help you, I think, help them transition back into what they want to do. And make them more knowledgeable, better mechanics, stronger kinetic chain, just really helps them to have a higher chance of performing at a high level for a longer period of time without injury again. So, thank everybody for their time.
Let's say you were going down, you were running down the stairs, and you slipped, and you're, you know, why I just saw it the other day, and your arm goes out, and you grab the rail, and you're not having too much success. You know, you get a good abduction, external rotation. Okay, your shoulders will come out of joint. If you're 25 years old and that happens, what's going to tear in the shoulder for it to come out of joint is sort of the anterior glenohumeral ligament structures. The labrum's going to tear off the ball, and you're going to have a capsule label in it, just like what I was talking about, what we're talking about here tonight. If you're 50 years old, same injury mechanism. More likely than not, when that mechanism occurs, your shoulder may come out of joint, but the ligaments didn't tear, which your cuff joint. So it's not that, well, the ligaments are that much stronger when you're 50. Of course they're not. It's just that rotator cuff has a precipitous decline in integrity as we get older. Now, you know, there's a lot of variability and health issues and exercise issues, nutrition issues, and all that. So, but you know, when you start getting into patients in their 40s and 50s who get stiff, generally you're not talking about instability surgery. One, they may be a little stiff beforehand. I think a lot of my orthopedic colleagues don't always recognize preoperative motion loss patterns. But a lot of it has to do with its age. And the other one core morbid issue, someone walks in your clinic, and something that I talk to Carrie and Paul about all the time is, you know, from my perspective of patients clinically, whatever their clinical problem is, they go through two doors to get me. Do you have diabetes or do you not have diabetes? If they have diabetes, you know, the shoulder has a unique predilection of a set of side effects from the existence of diabetes in their body. Now, it's more common insulin-dependent than non-dependent, but diabetic patients are more prone to a synovitis that can smolder and prolong. They're more prone to a stiffness in their shoulder. Doesn't mean they're going to get it, but it means that if they're diabetic, just be aware. But you know, sometimes the motion is a huge challenge, and it's probably a little bit of a different category of patient than we're talking about today, but without a doubt, it's central to the patient's dysfunction at that point, and your challenge as a physical therapist to try to render into them, you know, recovered.
Are you using the Wii at any point with your rehab?
No.
There's no evidence-based out.
Yeah, and I think it's a great tool. It's a great way to get people involved, and there's a lot of benefit to it, and some of the stuff is really great. I just I don't at this time have I don't say I don't have time, but I personally stick to some more of the manual techniques and things like that in exercise, but I think it definitely has its place and is very effective, but I don't use it in the clinic.
Laser to calm down
bursitis? I don't know.
I've heard of some fantastic results.
Yeah. you know, and it's, I don't want to say it's early out there, but in regards to the literature and the results, it is a little bit. I haven't used any, but I have patients who come see me frequently and ask me, or I actually had one patient who called and said, do you use laser therapy? And I said, no. She's like, okay, I won't be coming to you. I was like, okay. I mean, I don't want to equate it to ultrasound because I'm not real familiar with it, but I don't use it in clinic. I'm sure I've heard good results from it, but nothing personally. Is that a question for me or him or whoever?
Really, yeah, with the dislocations, the subluxation, and those symptoms. But anything that can speed up the recovery.
Well, the question is that the dead arm symptom complex. First off, it is a neuritic symptom. I think it's a brachial plexus irritation of some sort. It's usually self-limited. And it is a part of the art of the clinical assessment because it's this sort of, patients give you this sort of weird vagueness of it feels dead, heavy. You know, I sort of throw in a lot of adjectives at them. And, you know, and I'm careful at some point I don't want to put words in their mouth. But, you know, they'll have a sense that the shoulder just feels heavy or numb. Yeah. You know, maybe occasionally they'll get some radiating pain down their arm, but I don't see that as often. Now, the actual neuropraxia, which is that's a pathologic entity, you know, meaning that there is some injury to the axillary nerve. Now, with an abduction external rotation mechanism, which is an anterior dislocation, and if the shoulder comes out, and if that shoulder stays out for a period of time, how long varies, but if that thing's out for more than about 60 minutes, that the axillary nerve is stretched. I can tell you surgically, when the shoulder's put in that position, that nerve is tight. In fact, it's remarkable that we don't see more axillary nerve injury. So obviously the axillary nerve and the whole plexus, there is some plastic conformity available. It's not just a string between two rigid bodies, the brachial plexus. There's some, it can sort of move and glide a little bit. One thing to be always, if someone comes into you with an anterior instability diagnosis, be certain the axillary nerve is functioning. And just subtleties of deltoid function, the sensory distribution is a little patch right here. That can be kind of hard, I think, at times to kind of pick up. It's easy, it's dense, but if it's subtle, it's because they have been scrolling on their shoulder. But any other points about that?
No, I think in clinic you'd probably see it more with those who've suffered a traumatic dislocation than individuals who haven't. And really, with a traumatic dislocation, what we can afford those patients in regards to recovery oftentimes isn't very good compared to those who haven't had traumatic dislocation, oftentimes warrant some surgical intervention. But I haven't had to deal with a lot of that hasn't resolved with just the sort of the calming down of the shoulder and the general restoration of the stabilization of the shoulder. But I don't think I've seen it maybe in the degree in which you're talking about, or as he's talking about with the traumatic dislocation.
But the dead arm is a phenomenon of a mechanical instability of the shoulders coming out of joint, either partially, and just how the patient sort of interprets those symptoms. But usually any clinical consequence of neurologic injury is relegated to the axillary nerve, and it can be bad. It's something never to miss. You always in your initial assessment, if someone's had an anterior instability, you know. And I tell you, it's not uncommon. You know, someone dislocates their shoulder, you know, and there's no one around to reduce it for them. You know, they're not, it's not like on a competitive playing field. So they go to the ED. Well, they got to get there. So by the time they hit the ED, you know, it's been 20 minutes, 30 minutes, an hour, whatever. Then, you know, when you're in the ED, depending on where you're at, you know, the triage, that is not, you know, I mean, there's a lot of things that are more life-threatening than that, although I could argue that the nerve is being threatened. So it can be 90 minutes, 2 hours, and that nerve can take a hit. Now, generally, that nerve recovers. I might have seen two cases in 20 years where the nerve didn't recover. It's rare. And it can be dense initially. So the one thing, you know, is to you know, comport hope and, you know, yes, it's going to get better. It might take 2 months. It might take 4 months. It might take 6 months. But that nerve is going to come around. And generally it does. But boy, it can be real dense early. And it can be dense enough that they have sort of a pseudo subluxation. You put them in a sling. It's even, it can be a real issue. But that's something not to miss.
What's your opinion on thermal procedures? Do you ever do any of those as far as, not really for multi-directional, but for anterior instability?
So the question is thermal capsulography. About 1995 and 2003 was the heyday for that procedure. The rationale of it is collagen, when heated, denatures, and when reorganized, it's shorter. The analogy for patients who just had to have a visual analogy, because I used to do it in those days, is cooking a piece of bacon. You know, you heat the collagen, you kill it, or you kill a swath of it, and that collagen denatures, it molecularly rearranges because of it, and it's shorter. So when you would take a thermal probe of a certain heat and sort of stroke the capsule, you would sort of get the sort of volcano effect. It would shrink away. So it's a way. So intuitively, it was a way to almost like Crayola crayon the capsular plastic deformation problem. I mean, just stroke here, tighter here, you know, just, I mean, it could not be a simpler thing orthopedically. It could not be simpler just to take it and stroke the capsule. The challenge of it was twofold. One, it wasn't as clinically, it didn't hold up at 1 year, 2 years, 4 years as well as it did initially. But what killed it was complications. The number one complication was thermal necrosis, meaning you have treated the capsule and it looks like you've visually done what you intend to do, and unwittingly you've delivered more thermal energy to that ligament than you think you have. And over time it necroses, which means it not only dies, it just resorbs. It's a hole. It's like, you know, Star Trek with those phaser guns. I mean, it is a devastatingly bad problem. Devastatingly bad problem.
So you burnt the bacon. You burnt the bacon.
It's bad. And by around 2001, those complications are being seen. And I bet you, I probably haven't done one in 10 years. And I don't know anyone who really has done much. Now, I mean, I think they're done sporadically. The problem in orthopedics now, you know, could it be done sporadically? Yes. Is there a role for it? If it's done properly, probably. But as an orthopedic surgeon, if you do that procedure and you can do it perfect, and you get thermal necrosis, your lawsuits, you know, because it's already been established. So at some point, it's more of a legal, indefensible approach. But it had some efficacy because I was enthusiastic about it as well 15 years ago, but there's a lot of things in orthopedics that seem good and do good and turn bad. So the older I get, the less I am inclined to try new stuff. All the younger guys try new stuff. Yes.
In that particular instance, is the person then potentially long term going to have more instabilities? Are you essentially going to have holes there?
Holes.
You know.
Bad.
Okay.
It's a real bad problem. It means it's a lot like there's nothing to repair. So you have to render tissue into the area. You might take fasciolata, you know, you might do a number of things with it. And then all the surrounding tissue, so it's a little bit like in older days where women would get a lot of radiation surgery, radiation treatment for breast cancer when they were well shielded. The skin, you can say it looked a little bit different, but it looked generally okay, except you tried to operate on it. Then it didn't heal, it would drain, it was a mess. I mean, because that kind of thermal energy injury is hard to visibly discern, and it pervasively distorts collagen. It's thermal reconstructive surgery is just, you know, not thermal ablative surgery, meaning taking a, you know, cutting something in half. That's what thermal energy is used now for. But thermal reconstructive surgery, the collagen that we're based on is just—it's not well designed, at least not the musculoskeletal system. I want to thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
I also want to thank Paul for all of his hard effort putting this together. He organized it and managed to get the your state board to offer the continuing education credits and I enjoy doing this. I've always for years sort of had these sort of periodic time to speak with therapists. I think that the shoulder is uniquely well designed for, you know, sort of collegial discussion between therapists and people who do a lot of shoulder surgery, because the shoulder is the most rehab sensitive joint in the body. And the shoulder is, I've been doing it for 20 years, and I understand that. I mean, I may have a certain level of proficiency in repairing things, but the shoulder, more than most joints, I mean, I think the hand is similar, but tonight I'm talking about the shoulder, is that the anatomic restoration in the shoulder that can be rendered by surgery. I mean, you can get the best techniques, and I mean, I can be as refined and as skilled and as I want to be. Anatomic restoration is not necessarily lead to the clinical outcome the patient seeks. And how does the patient measure their satisfaction? It's clinical outcome, which means this is the antithesis to me of neurosurgery. Because neurosurgeons, I mean, I have great regard for them, but a lot of times with neck surgery, I mean, you know, they'll do a ACDF and infuse it, and then afterwards, if their neck still hurts, you know, they'll look at it and say, "You still hurt? Go to the pain clinic." You know, the patients in the shoulder measure their outcome by restoration of function, amelioration of pain, and sleep. Okay. The prerequisite for that, from a surgical perspective, from my perspective, is restoring anatomy and understanding the importance of the rehabilitative progression. And if they don't rehab properly, then they're not going to do well. And a lot of the patients don't connect the dots. All they know, you know, I went to Dr. Spear to fix my shoulder. Well, listen, you know. So they're all that. The therapy is so critically important, and I think that it just allows a real diverse opportunity to start coming up on a diverse number of topics. I mean, we could, you know, you mentioned about stiffness. You could wander in the area. What do you do with a stiff shoulder? Christ, that's a whole another topic. That is immensely challenging. Well, stiffness from what kind of surgery? Well, rotator cuff surgery, that's one whole another topic. I mean, it's a myriad of challenges, and I think that many times therapists are put in an awkward position if they're given a post-operative patient with the parameters of evaluate and treat. I think it's, sort of, if I were in your shoes, I wouldn't like that, because, you know, they're like, whoa, what about, you know, parameters? What can I do? What are the risks here? You know, when you're mobilizing the shoulder, and that patient tells you with clarity, "I think you're going to tear me apart," or I think you're going to hurt my surgery. You know, they are getting some reassurance from you that this is normal. It begins with you having knowledge it's normal. And that's why, you know, for this, usually stiffness is a huge issue in this, but say for work, working your cuff repair is a much more common issue. You know, if I'll say I'm going to let you go to 104 degrees of elevation at 5 weeks after 5 weeks after surgery, and then, you know, one of you have one of my patients, and this is why I like protocols. You know, if they're at 110, so this is a stiff shoulder. This is a tough shoulder. It's stiff. It's just not behaving well, and you're pushing them, and the patient is articulating that, you know, you're going to tear this up. You're going to tear up my shoulder. You know, you have to sort of reassure them that this is not. And, you know, and it begins with a knowledge from the surgeon of the parameters. So I would urge you, you know, to seek parameters. I try to encourage my orthopedic colleagues. I think the shoulder is better designed with the knowledge of what the motion parameters can withstand at a certain time course after surgery. Because not everyone unfolds nice and neat and pretty. So a lot of people get stiff and painful with myofascial overlay, and then they get anxious, and then they draw some rapid conclusions. You know, they are convinced that you're going to, you know, the shoulder's going to be torn up or something like that. And it's a challenge, and it, you know, I think it begins with understanding the parameters within which you can work. And surgeons know those parameters. I think a lot of times they just under-recognize how important therapy is for the shoulder. And I think a lot of that is, you know, some of those patients never get the outcomes that they might have otherwise had the potential to get because their anatomy was nicely rendered. Nice. And that is that you know, that is merely a prerequisite for clinical outcome excellence. That is not assurance. It's not an assurance. That being said, I give some final housekeeping issues, and I'll turn over the reverse to Paul.
So just again, thanks. Just again, thanks everybody for coming out.